So thanks very much for inviting me, and I'm so sorry I can't be there in person. I always joke that, you know, I'm an affiliate in philosophy, and you can always tell the difference between my philosophy talks and my psychology talks, because the philosophy ones don't have any data and have really terrible PowerPoint. So you're going to get a philosophy talk this time instead of a psychology talk, although I'll have a little bit of data. And this is a bunch of new ideas that I've had recently. And they'll actually be in an essay that will be in the Wall Street Journal on Saturday, and I can send it, or you can look at it in the Wall Street Journal on Saturday. Okay, so as we all know, and as I'm sure people have been discussing here, recently there was a brouhaha about whether Lambda, which is one of these large language models, was actually a sentient intelligent agent. And pretty much everybody except this Google engineer said that they weren't. But of course, the debate was a debate about whether or not Lambda was an intelligent agent. And a lot of debates about recent advances in AI have that character. So is it in fact the case that an AI system, particularly a large language model, is, you know, a genius like Alan Turing? Or is it just a deceptive double talk bull artist like the famous Professor Owen Corey, who I highly suggest you go and look up on YouTube? Double talk artists were people who learned how to just produce a string of words that sounded like they made sense, but didn't actually. And some people have argued that GPT-3 or the large language models are more like that. But what I want to argue is that that's the wrong way of thinking about it, that it, especially for large language models and for lots of recent AI, the view of thinking of them by comparison with an individual agent is just the wrong way of thinking about them. And instead, what I want to argue is that we should think about these systems, especially the large language models, as being cultural technologies. What do I mean by cultural technology? I mean a technology that allows humans to access and summarize and use all the other knowledge and discoveries that other humans have made over the generations. So it's not a technology that itself is intelligent, but it's one that's sort of essential for human intelligence because it allows humans to access the intelligence of other humans. And you could make a good argument that the sort of example of this is language itself, which enables us to, say, tell another hunter that we found game, or it lets a grandmother, and grandmothers are probably very much the relevant category here, pass on information about foraging to the next generation. Writing is, so language is sort of the example of this kind of cultural technology. But I think there's a good argument that much of human progress has been the result of changes and progress in these cultural technologies. So writing itself is another example of something that now enables you not only to access the knowledge of the people close to you, but the knowledge of people who are hundreds of years past or hundreds of miles away. And print obviously turns up the dial on writing. So once you have print, you can access even more information from even more people. And there's good reason to believe that print was responsible for the Enlightenment, for liberal democracy, for a lot of the changes, for industrialization, for a lot of the changes in the long 18th century. Libraries are another example of kind of cultural technology that enables us to access more information. And of course, more recently, we have the very phenomenon of internet search itself and phenomena like Wikipedia that are also these technologies that don't actually produce knowledge or information themselves, but give us more efficient ways of accessing the knowledge or information that other people before us or in different places have actually produced. And it's just wrong to think about these cultural technologies as like agents. So, you know, asking whether Lambda is intelligent or not is like asking whether the University of California, Berkeley library is intelligent or not, or whether Google search knows the answer to your questions or not. It's just the wrong category. And what I want to argue is that Lambda and other AIs are this kind of a thing, this kind of a technology, not what you might think of as the classic artificial intelligence in, say, robotics, where you're actually trying to design an independent agent that will go out into the world and be intelligent. Now, that is not at all to minimize the importance of these technologies. In fact, there's a pretty strong argument made by people like Dick Boyd and Peter Richeson and Joseph Henrich that cultural ability, the ability to have cultural technologies, is exactly what makes humans special. So other animals do pass on information from generation to generation to some extent, but none of them does it in the way that we do. and to the extent that we do, and certainly for as long over many generations as we do. And there's a good argument that it's exactly that ability to take on information from previous generations that enables us to function as well as we do. You could paraphrase Newton and say, all of us are standing on the shoulders of all of those who have come before us. So adding a cultural technology actually makes a big difference to human intelligence. And of course, what large language models do and other AI models like ImageNet or DALL-E do is not produce language themselves. What they do is summarize billions and billions and billions of sentences that have been placed out on the web by other humans. All right, so what's missing? If in fact, what's most important for human intelligence is this transfer of knowledge and belief from one generation to another, why not say that GPT-3 or Lambda is intelligent? Well, this process of cultural evolution, as people call it in biology and psychology, depends on a balance between two different processes. They're typically described as imitation versus innovation. So the idea is that one part of cultural evolution is that you take on the information and the practices of the people before you through imitation. And as many people have pointed out, something like Lambda is a super imitator. That's really what it's doing. It's just doing a massively good job of imitating the patterns that it sees out there in the world of text. But then doing that imitation wouldn't be worth anything. It wouldn't help you unless there were people who were also innovating, unless there were generations that were also going beyond just what the previous generation had done to go out and actually explore the world, find things not that are expected, but things that are unexpected, find things that are novel. And of course, again, Lambda works by saying, here's what the most likely thing would be given this, here's the most likely continuation given this text. And in fact, for innovation, what you need to do is do just the opposite. You need to look out for things that are unexpected that you wouldn't have thought of in the first place. And here's where my tiny bit of empirical work has come. I've argued that children and childhood in particular are really well designed for this innovation niche as well as the imitation niche. And in an experiment that we just recently published on Archive, what we did was actually look at causal learning in particular, which is something I've been looking at for the last 20 years, really, really important way of learning about the world, maybe the most important way that humans live independently learn about the world through exploration and trying to find cause and effect relationships. And what we did was just design a very simple set of tasks with an online Blicket detector. The Blicket detector is the way that we found out about causation. And the way this works is you just put things on the detector and the detector lights up sometimes and not others. And you have to figure out how it works. And the criterion for how it works is that at the end, we ask the kids, and we do this with 3 and 4 and 5 year olds, tell me which one is a Blicket. The Blickets make it go and see if you can make it work yourself. So it's quite a simple task, but children turn out to be extremely good at it. Even very young children are very good at making inferences about the structure. And we thought this is such a simple task that surely in those billions of texts that that something like GPT-3 is using, there should be the information that you need to know what the right consequence, what the right answer to these questions are. And there is some work and some evidence that in some contexts, something like GPT can do everyday reasoning. But again, there's a lot of everyday reasoning already embedded in the texts that it's learning from. And in fact, no one had ever seen this particular machine with this particular structure, with this particular pattern before in all of those texts, in all of that time until the children are actually seeing it. So what we discovered was even in this online setting, which is kind of interesting in and of itself, the children are very good at exploring. They'll try different kinds of combinations and try and test them, do kind of everyday experiments. And in about 20 trials, they solve the problem. We also tested sort of state-of-the-art reinforcement learning mechanisms on this, and they take about 150,000 trials to solve this problem. And here's an example of a child actually playing with it, so you can see how it, you can see how it works. And you know, in terms of innovation, as I say, I think it's interesting. 20 years ago when we started doing this work, the kids would not have been happy about doing this on a computer screen, and now they're perfectly happy about doing it on a computer screen. But when we gave it not only to GPT-3, but also to Palm, which is the even more recent and more powerful version, they were surprisingly bad at it. And it was only if we gave them specific training about this is applicable and this isn't that they did well at all. Okay, so that suggests that GPT-3 isn't doing everything that you would want to do to have intelligence. Intelligence depends both on being able to access information from the past and being able to innovate and do things in the future. Now, as I was saying, the prevailing view about the evolution of human intelligence is that this kind of cultural technology is really crucial to that intelligence. That raises the question, okay, is turning up the capacity for cultural technologies a good thing or a bad thing? And going back, you know, it's good in the sense that that's what we evolved to do, but going all the way back in human history, there's always been both sides. So the fact given that humans are racist and sexist and irrational and biased and have all these problems in their cognition, depending on the cognition and knowledge and beliefs of other people, is always going to be this double-edged sword. Because on the one hand, you're going to get the information about where the game is. But on the other hand, and evolutionary biologists have argued this, there's now an incentive for the other hunter to mislead you about where the game is so he can get all the game himself. And with each iteration of new cultural technologies, this tension between getting the truth from other people and being deceived by other people has been a feature of the cultural changes themselves. And as I'm sure everybody here knows, famously, for example, Socrates thought that writing was a really bad idea for cultural transmission. It's funny because I actually found this quote, and it could be talking about GPT-3 because he says, they seem to talk to you as though they were intelligent. This is him, Socrates, talking about written books. But ask them anything about what they say, they'll just go on telling you, just the same thing forever. So Socrates is describing written books in a way that sounds very much like the way that we might describe GPT-3. It just goes on telling you the same thing forever. And Socrates is contrasting that with Socratic dialogues, famously so-called, where you're dealing with a real live person and you can alter and change and respond to what the person has asked you. Print is another nice example of a technology that both had positive and negative consequences. So this is actually a picture of Benjamin Franklin, who was famously a printer. And Franklin and the other founders, other Enlightenment figures, used the innovations that made printing much cheaper and much easier in the 18th century to actually spread the word about things like liberal democracy. And those, you know, arguably, changes like the American Revolution couldn't have happened without this cheap pamphlet technology. On the other hand, Robert Daunton many years ago pointed out that the same kinds of technologies in the case of France also produced large amounts of obscenity and libel and really, you know, stuff that's so horrible that it would put even the current, you know, put even Twitter to shame, and indeed was responsible for some of the worst features of the French Revolution. So that's another example of where you get the two sides of cultural technologies and cultural evolution. And the way that people have dealt with this over the years is that as each of these cultural technologies emerges, there's a new set of norms, rules, regulations, laws. This is something that I know you've been talking about in this group that emerged to deal with this double-edged sword of cultural evolution. And we've shown in empirical evidence that even very young children, even four-year-olds, have norms about being truthful. So for example, if you have someone lie to a kid several times, they'll stop trusting that person. So they're already using information about the past testimony and reliability of past testimony to make new inferences. And there's a whole giant bunch of evidence that suggests that that's true. So this is even with 3 and 4 year olds. And then we have institutions like testifying under oath. We have new categories of people like editors or journalism professors or journalism schools, fact checkers. We have new laws, libel laws, privacy laws, defamation suits, and so forth. It wouldn't make any sense to have had a fact checker before you actually had, before you had print. It wouldn't make any sense to have a fact checker in the context of, say, an oral society. So I think the punchline, which I imagine is kind of a punchline here as well, is that it's, we shouldn't be thinking about these things in terms of, is this, you know, the golem who's going to come and kill us all in our beds because it will become a sentient agent. I think you might want to worry about that, but one of the things I say is, as a mother, one of the things you learn how to do is ration your worries to the ones that are going to be worse. But you certainly could worry about the potential effects of a new form of cultural technology, a new form of cultural evolution, and do all of the kinds of things that you that we've done in the past to make sure that that cultural technology ends up being beneficent instead of malign. And I'll stop there.
Okay, thanks. Sticking right on 15 minutes, so thank you. I think we'll jump to our second speaker now, who will go on for about 15 minutes again, then we'll do a group Q&A. So